So good to see everyone here today. Please make your way inside. I'm not shouting, not yet. We have a really good Sunday ahead of us. We have Charles from Arkansas, unlike Marco's mistake last week, Arkansas. Charles is from Arkansas. We have him ministering with us today. And just as we head into a time of worship, Carrie brought in the prayer meeting just that song of, coming back to the heart of worship. And that's kind of what's been on my heart. So yes, I am holding our, not newborn baby anymore, our one-year-old baby. And there's that scripture in Philippians 3:8 where it says, indeed, I count everything as a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. And what's been interesting, obviously having a newborn up to one-year-old, is the only reason she knows that I'm her dad is because of the time that I spend in her house with her. So yes, I've been there her whole life, and that's her association, hence why she's scared of Marco, because Marco hasn't been involved in her life nearly as much as I've been. And it's just an interesting thought that the relationship that we have and how we grow with Christ is the amount of time that we spend with him. So as we come into this meeting, this worship service, let's just have that thought in our heads. Let's strip away all the distractions that we have, and let's push in, and let's have a relationship with Jesus, with the Lord, as he wants to have one with us as well. All righty, let's pray, and then we'll start. Thank you, Lord, for this Sunday. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Father, that knowing you is the greatest gift and blessing that we actually have. And, Father, as we come this Sunday to spend worshiping you, to hear the message that you have for us, would you help us just lay aside all those distractions, all those things that are grabbing our attention, and we would just come with our eyes fixed and focused on you. Come back to the heart of worship. Come back to the heart of who you are, and that is you, Jesus. We love you dearly. We just say thank you for the blessing again that we have been able to come worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, church, let's worship.
Grace on top of grace, more than I've asked for, more than I'm worth. Grace on top of grace, how sweet the sound, once lost and now found. Heaven, oh, you came down and grace rescued me. From my sin and penalty, at the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Hey!
Alright, church, let's sing that again.
Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve. Grace on top of grace, more than I. Grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace, with your grace on top of. Grace on top of grace. Hallelujah.
Amen. Give him some praise this morning.
You are enough. All my
Thank you, Jesus.
Hi, church. My name is Micah, and I've spent some time in Colorado kind of getting away from everything. And the most important thing I learned is your testimony is important. God has changed you. And I saw lives change this week simply by saying what's been done. So let's sing this new song. I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Be seated, please.
Hey, Hope Rock Church, Audrey here. I just wanted to let you know that there are three ways to give here at Hope Rock Church: by dropping your tithes or offerings in our designated giving box found just outside the auditorium doors, online through our website, or by mailing us a check. We love you, church, and thank you for your continued support and your heart of generosity.
Fighting. It's all around us. Political fighting, social media fighting. Nations are fighting, spouses are fighting. Doctors and nurses are fighting to save lives. Some are fighting social and racial injustice. The fighting is rampant. It's a way of life. It's been around since the beginning of time, and it's not letting up anytime soon. Who are you fighting? What are you fighting? Perhaps it's none of the battles previously mentioned, but most of us are fighting something. Are you fighting addiction? Fighting with your wife, your neighbors? Perhaps your fighting is internal, not easily detected. You're fighting that shameful habit or fighting your past. Whatever the battle you are facing, there is one worth fighting. And if won, will help you conquer all of those other battles. What is the battle you should be fighting in? It's fighting the good fight of faith. 1 Timothy 6:12 puts it this way. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called. Fight Club at Hope Rock Church is a place where you can train with other men to become the man that God created you to be. It's a safe place where men can be real with other men, a place of encouragement, a place of camaraderie, a place of prayer and Bible study, a place where men encourage other men to fight the good fight of faith. For more information on Fight Club, visit hoperockchurch.com. I look forward to seeing you at Fight Club. And remember, it's okay to talk about Fight Club.
Remember, right on. I love that last line. It kills me every time. So there are people in your life, I hope, that just bring you to Jesus and bring you close and encourage you when you're struggling. And I'm going to tell you what, today I'm super excited that our friend Charles is here. I met Charles before I met Crystal, I think. Because he and my brother-in-law, Charles, were friends. And so it's the three Charlies. And we've had a good time for these 35-some-odd years. And Charles is, he's Uncle Charles to my kids. And he's just a brother to me, and I'm super excited. He has walked with me through dark times and through good times. And I'm just going to tell you, there's few people in the world that you're just like, okay, there's the love of Jesus, and he's one of them. And so I'm excited that Charles is here to share with us today, because I think you're going to be blessed. If you're online, you're going to be blessed. But if you're in here, you're really going to be blessed, you know, because this is where the fire is right here. So get excited. Charles, come on, brother.
Follow instructions very well. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. It's great to be in Texas with you guys. What a joy. And having just met your pastors last night and some of you, most of you today for the first time, can I just say I thank God for the body of Christ because we're not strangers. Amen. Ever. But we are just family that we have not met yet. And so it has been a great blessing on Friday night at the wedding. I got to meet some of the family here at Hope Rock Church. I was thinking Hope Rockin' Church. But I mean, Hope Rock Church. It's great to be with you. My nieces and nephews says, Uncle Charles, you're too old to be cool, so don't even try. So I gave up being cool a long time ago. I'm just going to be me. That's all right. I am from Southeast Arkansas. I have 9 brothers. I was born into a family of 9 brothers and 3 sisters. And at last count, 78 nieces, nephews, great nieces, and nephews. So it is an amazing journey. I was born in, my mom and dad were both, we grew up in the rural country part of Arkansas. My dad was a hired hand on a farm, so we grew up. My dad was a laborer, and my mom worked in homes as a cook and in the cafeteria at the school and even in the cotton fields. And I've worked the cotton fields, the bean fields, and I picked pecans in the pecan orchard in the fall just to make extra money for Christmas spending. And I didn't live in a house with running water until I was a junior in high school. And people are going, you don't look that old. Well, I'm not that old. I was just, my circumstances were that old. I'm not that old. But I thank God today that at the age of 10, I walked down the aisle of a little country church and I asked Jesus to come into my heart. I didn't know the impact of that decision then, but I am so thankful. I wouldn't trade one moment of the journey today. I'm thankful for parents that though they didn't have much in their hands, they had a lot in their hearts. And they taught us about Jesus. And for that, I'm grateful. I'm thankful today that Jesus is someone that I gave my heart to. And over time, I've come to know as my Savior, my Lord, my friend, my helper. And I'm so grateful today to say, God, thank you that you've allowed me to do this journey over the years. And how many know that as our brother, Brother Tim, was holding this little blessing up here this morning, right? And as he was holding that little blessing, and he was talking about how the baby knows him because she's around him. It's a she. She's around him. And, there they are. And you know, the Bible says, Jesus says, my sheep know me because they know my voice. And that's by spending time. And there have been times when the enemy has tried to pull me away from Jesus because he didn't want me to know Jesus. He didn't want me to get familiar with that voice that gives strength in my darkness and become light in my darkness and strength in my weaknesses. He doesn't want us to have that knowledge. And I grew up on a farm, like I said, and we would be outside playing late at night and a voice would pierce the darkness. And I knew it was Willie Graham, my dad. It wasn't Emma West. It wasn't Frank Berkeley. It was Willie Graham. And when my name was called, I'd better stop what I was doing and head home. Because my dad, of all these kids, we knew his voice. And there was a part of his voice we didn't want to know that well, but we knew that part as well. And he also had a look that was familiar and wasn't always pleasant. But I'm grateful to know that out of all of that, there is something that is precious about knowing him. Not about him. In the beginning, I knew about him, but over time, I got to know him. And even knowing about him was a blessing, but oh, how the blessings increased when I knew him. Amen. And knowing about him as a young teenager, I was a little challenged at the fact that I would read the word of God and I would read where he had a plan for my life and he knew us before we were formed in our mother's womb, and I would get ready to go to the cotton fields, and I would say to God, if you knew me before I was formed in my mother's womb, then why was I born poor? Why is life so difficult? Why is it such a struggle? Why at Christmas my brother and I had to share an old rusty bicycle? Why? I knew about him, and just knowing about him made me question him. And you know how I love God. He doesn't have a problem with us questioning him because that's how he grows us. I didn't like everything my dad did. Now, I didn't always question my dad, but I questioned him in my head and in my heart. I just didn't always question him with my mouth because I watched my brothers question him and they had to get up off the floor. And I had enough sense to know that I may question you, but I'm going to question you in silence. I'll tell you one thing. I don't know what you're talking about. Why do you want me to do that? But with God, it's okay. And it took me a long time to just know that it's okay to talk to God and share my heart, what's real. Because I grew up thinking it had to be religious and had to be spiritual. And somehow I didn't know how to be real with God. Even though he knew already, I would disguise what I'm coming to him about. I would make it sound real spiritual. I'd rehearse it as if he didn't already know. But I'm thankful today, and I just want to stand here before you to say, at the age of 10, walking down that aisle, to the age of almost 64, come the 23rd of this month, God has made an amazing change in my life. And it hasn't all been pretty. It hasn't all been good. But I can tell you this much, it has all been worth it. I am so thankful this morning that God, when he says that he has a hold on us and he will not let go, I'm thankful, because there were many days I wanted to let go, but he wouldn't let go. There were days when I didn't understand and I was confused, I was hurt, I was angry, I was mad, and he was just a loving father. And he loved me back to his heart, to his presence. And I'm thankful today to say that because of his love in my life, I have found that grace that is sufficient. I've found that grace that is amazing. And I just want to encourage you this morning to just know that some of you may be in the journey for a short period. Some of you may have been in the journey like me a very long time. But I'm discovering that we never arrive. It's a journey, and it'll be a journey until we see him face to face. I used to think if I could just get here, enough faith, if I could just get enough of this, then it's going to change. It's going to be different. It won't be as hard. It won't be a struggle. But how many know that no matter how much faith you get, there's still more faith to be received? I've come to realize that God is like that diamond, that no matter what facet you're looking at, it's wonderful, but if you turn it a little bit more, there's another facet you've never seen. Moses understood it. He says, I just need to see you. Because if you're gonna use me, then Lord, just let me see your face. Because I gotta know you. And God says, and this is a man who knew him from what we could read, but Moses understood that what you're calling me to do, what you're expecting of me, God, then there's something that's greater. I need to know another measure of you that I've never seen before. And the Bible says that God hid him in the cleft of the rock. And as he passed by him, he allowed him to see his back parts. That was his glory. Moses saw a measure of God's glory he had never seen before. And in Genesis, it says he went out and did things that had never been done before. And I've discovered that if I want to go and do things that I've never done before, if I want to go farther than I've ever gone before, then I've got to see God in a way I've never seen him before. Because the measure that I've seen him will take me to this place. And that's a good place. But how many know that it's not just a good place where God leaves us? He's got an even better place, a more increase. He moves us from faith to faith and from glory to glory. Amen. He is an inexhaustible God. And how wonderful it is to know that today. And I am thankful for the God that is inexhaustible, and we will, and as long as we are seeking him, the Bible says we will find him if we seek him with our whole heart. So I just thank God for that. I thank God for who he is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So can I encourage you to seek him today? Don't quit seeking him. And that's what I love about the body of Christ. Growing up on a farm and in a community where they said you're poor and you're black and you won't amount to much. I heard that over and over and over. But at the age of 10, I gave my heart to Jesus. I began to read in the Word of God where it says, all things are possible to those who believe. Amen. And I began to believe the Word rather than the world. Yeah. And my brothers, when you began to read the Word and believe the Word that is within, you can live and not have to be moved by the world that you're in. And so my life is, at one time it was defined by the world I was in, but over time it is defined by the Word that is within. And that's why church is not an accident. It's a planned purpose of God. The Bible tells us in Isaiah that God is vast and he's great. Who's counseled with him? No one has counsel with him. So I just encourage you. Know him. Not just mama's God, not just daddy's God, but know him for yourself. Oh Lord, my God,
when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, Lord.
And when I think that our God, his own Son, not sparing, sent him to die, what joy fills my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
Thank you.
When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation to take us home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in a humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Would you just sing with me? Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Amen. Amen. How great is our God. How great is our God. I am so thankful today that God continues to make his greatness known. He says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And my prayer is, God, let me be aware of your goodness and your mercy that's following me. Because it's around us. It's just whether or not we see it. And let us have eyes to see God's goodness. Because it's easy to have the natural eyes see what it sees, what they see. And we are moved and directed by that. But I tell you, the eyes of the Spirit. Let us see what the Lord is doing, and let us hear what the Lord is saying. Amen. This morning, my heart is leaning towards, they often ask, what's the title? And I sometimes can follow that title, and sometimes I don't. But it's just a joy to be here with you guys. I just appreciate the body of Christ. And to me, that is becoming a valuable part, like Brother Charlie was saying, and I appreciate his introduction. His family has been such an amazing gift to me, because I know that the journey and where I am today is because God has placed people in my life that has prayed for me, stood with me, and loved me when I wasn't lovable. And have cared for me and have been patient with me and have just been consistent with me. And growth comes out of that kind of journey. Because it's easy to be in the journey, and if we don't like something, if we don't want to change, if we don't want to do it God's way, we just go find another place, another group, and we start over. But when you are... That's why the Bible talks about remaining in Christ. Amen. Not just uprooting and popping off and leaving when we feel like we want to leave. We don't like what the word says. We don't like what the preacher is preaching about. We just go find another place that, you know, that we can start over. But how many know that roots can't grow deep and grow strong? That tree becomes weak if the roots don't grow deep. And I've looked at my own life and I realize why it's been so easy for me to let go and move on and walk away is because I'm not allowing my roots, the roots of Christ, to grow deep in my life, or the word to grow deep, because I get offended by something and I'm easily, I've got a farm here in Arkansas and I've lost 3 pecan trees, and they've been around for a long time, but they weren't strong enough. 3 of them weren't strong enough to withstand the winds. Now, we did a nice clearing out, and I've been able to put my old church in that spot where I was born again. I moved that church to that clearing in the pecan orchard. But I looked at those trees in the beginning, and I'm thinking, now, out of all 50-plus trees, those 3 planted around the same time, but they didn't withstand the same winds that the others did. Somehow, the roots didn't go deep enough to withstand. It looks good. Until the winds came. And my brothers and sisters, I've been like those trees. I have looked good, but whose roots were not deep. But I'm telling you, it's the ones that will survive are the ones who will allow their roots to go deep, beyond the pain, beyond the disappointment, beyond the all the things that the enemy likes to use to keep us from growing deep in the Lord. I've been there. I haven't always liked what my pastors had to say, but the Lord says, he's your pastor. I know, but God, don't you understand? I'm on staff now, and they've asked me to be on staff, and I've got great ideas in my little office, and I go to the board meeting, and I bring forth my wonderful godly ideas, and they're going, no, I don't think we're going to do that. I don't think we're going to do that. Don't you know I've been in there praying, and I've been trusting God and seeking God, and I've really, this is the word of the Lord. No, we're not going to do that. Well, I don't think this is where God wants me. I'm just going to move on someplace else. And God says, no, I'm not going to move you. But God, I can't fulfill what you've called me to do. Yeah, yeah, you can. But God, I may know that God wins. Amen. You know what he said to me? And it wasn't really about the issue that I was looking at. What God spoke to my heart was, I may move you, and one day I will move you, but I'll never move you out of a hurt or disappointment. I'll heal you before I move you. Now, let me just go now, because it ain't working. No, it's not working in you. My brothers and sisters, there is something about going deep in the Lord. And I look at this family, and I know that there's a family online today. Can I just encourage you? Just make that decision like Joshua made. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. And do you know the difference between risk going deep and just being on the surface is a decision and a choice that we make. And say, God, I will remain steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. And so I'm thankful this morning. I'm thankful for God's goodness. As I said earlier, starting off life with what I thought were disadvantages, starting off life with people telling me that I was at a disadvantage. And for a long time, I believed that, which is why it surprised me when I found that God said, before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. I had a big problem with that. And why was I born poor? Why was I born black? Why is it that I was born in this town in the South? Why? Why? It took me a journey to understand that what I didn't know then, God knew. What I didn't understand, he did already. And it wasn't an accident that I was born to Willie and Ollie Graham in Boydell, Arkansas. And if you know where that is, I'm going to pray for you. And my dad says, the day that I was born, the midwife slapped me, and the farm had a deep well, and it had an electric pump on it. And I was born August 23rd, 1956. And the moment that I arrived in the world, the pump exploded and broke, and the landowner blamed my dad for having a boy born. Somehow I was connected to the pump breaking down. And I've never been fond of the farm since then. I'm still not. But God has been so good. And I look back at those years where I despised the journey. Instead of getting to know the God in the journey, I was looking at the journey. But over time, I began to move my focus from the stuff of the journey to the God of my journey. And I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, it's just a matter of perspective. When you move from looking at the stuff of your journey to the source of your journey, that's why the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, looking unto Jesus. But no, this is what they said about me. No, looking unto Jesus. This is what's happening around me. This is what they're doing, looking unto Jesus. Amen. There were times when I looked at Jesus, and there were times I looked at the natural. And the natural only caused more pain, more hurt, more disappointment. Looking at Jesus brought peace, and I saw the plans that he had for me, that God had. But I'm telling you, if we're not looking unto Jesus, there is no forgiveness. And because our humanity does not seek to forgive, our humanity seeks to get even. Our humanity seeks to solve the problem, whatever, by whatever means necessary. And so it depends on the environment that you grew up in as to how your humanity will dictate your journey. If you grew up in a rough home, cussing, drinking, beating, fighting, guess how your humanity wants to resolve your issues? Absolutely the same. But see, when you get born again, Jesus breaks through the humanity. Now, it's not completely resolved, but he breaks through the humanity, and our spirits are born again. And then our flesh has to learn how to be obedient to our spirits, not our spirits obedient to our flesh. And I had to learn that. So if you would, let's look at Romans 12, if you would, please. And the title for the lesson today is Speaking the Truth in Love, which is found in Ephesians. But I want to just a little bit of the background is because I know for me, I didn't get to the speaking my truth in love until I discovered the God of my journey. You know, how do you get to speaking the truth in love? When we don't grow up, we don't start speaking the truth in love. We don't even really start speaking, we don't start life speaking the truth. Let alone in love. But as we grow up, we realize, okay, truth is, you know, we've been told, tell the truth, tell the truth, tell the truth. And so then truth becomes a part of our life. But the world can tell the truth, but Jesus understood, God understood that the value is not just in the truth, but the truth being spoken in love. I don't know about down here in Texas, but in Arkansas, they said, I'm going to give you a piece of my mind. Now, we didn't have enough to give away, but we were still giving it out to everybody we saw. We're going to give a little. That's why we go crazy, because we ain't got no mind left. We done gave it out to everybody. And usually that doesn't mean I'm going to speak the truth in love. A piece of my mind is mean I'm going to tell you what I think, how I feel, whether you like it or not. And so how do we get from the influences of our natural existence to the place where God says, this is who you are? Because we're born with an identity. How many know that we're born again with an identity? But often we let our born again identity be defined by our first birth. A friend of mine in Africa said, you know, my destiny is not defined by my first birth, but by my second birth. But yet, I found in my own life that so much of my life existence, experiences, relationships, even as a Christian, I'm living those experiences out from my first birth experiences, my first birth influences, and not my second birth. And I realized I was 10 when I asked Jesus into my heart, and that's not a lot of years to understand what that means. But over time, God wants us to grow and to develop. That's why he talked about going from a baby to the youth to the adult. We're to be maturing in the things of God. Just like we mature as humans, we're to mature as spiritual children and beings as well. We would think it's strange that a baby remains a baby at 35 years old, and that 35-year-old is still sucking a bottle and doing things that a baby would do. We would look at that as strange, but yet somehow in the body of Christ, we've allowed the spiritual life to, we can be 35 years in the Lord, and yet we're still mad and angry and hurt and acting like a baby. But I'm telling you, God had to transform my life. Let's look here in Romans 12. Beginning at verse 1, it says, therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. And then look at verse 9. It says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Not lagging behind in diligence. Fervent in spirit. Serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope. Preserving in tribulation. Devoted to prayer. Contributing to the needs of the saints. Practicing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind one towards another. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all men. If possible, so far as that depends on you, be at peace with all men. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And if he is thirsty, give him drink. For in doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. I heard that as a child, and I thought that meant burning them up with love until I went to Israel. And I realized that the coals on their head is an act of love, is an act of service, because when we would travel through the night, there was some kind of like an apparatus made for the top of the head. And as a guest would leave your home, you would put the coals in their that apparatus so that as they walk through the night, in the cold night, they were kept warm. So now a mad person reads this and you say, I'm going to just burn them up with love. I'll just burn them up any way I can. If love is going to burn them up, then I'll just burn them up with love. I just want them burned up. No, it wasn't a hateful, evil act. It was an act of love. But look at all that the word is saying here. Look at what God is calling us to, how we're to live. And my brothers and sisters, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to understand that there is a stark difference between the life of a non-believer and the life of a believer. So we're born into a world. I was born into a community. I was born into a family that didn't have much. I was born into a community that had racial division. I was born, and when I went to elementary school, first through seventh grade, was segregation. Our textbooks that we received there was two schools in the little rural community where I grew up, the white school and the black school, one superintendent for both schools. We got the textbooks after the white students. And the real tragedy is that when we got them, they wrote their names in them, but never the answers. I just kind of hope they would write the answers in sometime. Every once in a while, they'd stick an answer in there. We never found answers, just in their names. But, and so we could spend a lifetime, which is what we're seeing in the world today. We're seeing people spend a lot of energy and efforts reacting from their first birth position. Now, I didn't have a choice at where I was born or who I was born to, because if I had, I would not have chosen those circumstances. But he knew me before I was from my mother's womb. Okay, you said that. I've already read that. I just don't understand it. But he says, just keep on living. Just keep, stay close to me. But God, no, just stay with me. Stay with me. And so life happens. We integrate. And we're in another school now, and private schools are popping up because integration and all of that was happening in my community. There was a restaurant that no blacks were allowed to eat inside the restaurant. We had to get our meal at the back door. All of my natural existence. But I'm born again, but not walking in the truth of being born again. So therefore, I love God, but I'm affected by my circumstances. So I'm going to church, I'm loving God, but I'm allowing the natural circumstances to determine, dictate my life. And so I'm reacting. And I tell you the difference. I've learned that a reaction is when your flesh is engaged, and a response is when your spirit is engaged. See, the devil wants us to react, and God wants us to respond. Because a response from God means that we spend time with him. There's prayer. And then there's a response. The enemy says, no, just react. We can react to a spouse. We can react to a child. We can react to a parent. We can react to the neighbor. Living in California, I moved into this condominium complex, and I was only black living in the complex. And I remember when I moved in, and my neighbor straight across, an older couple, they was just watching out the window. And I just wave, and I'm from the South. How y'all doing? Hey. Every time I'm waving at everybody, you know. I later discovered that they'd been up there for 35 years, and they didn't even know each other hardly. But I got to know Chris and Miss Bartlett and Jim and Clara. I got to know them all, and they had been up there with each other. So finally, Jim came up one day and goes, well, Charles, I'll tell you one thing. You ever had a white person try to sound like a black person, and then a black person sound like a white person? I'm just going to be real today because this is what we think. Yeah, I know y'all got a way of saying things that we say. We got a way of saying things that y'all say. Anyway, Jim says, hey, Charles. I'm just kidding. I just added a little bit extra there. But Jim came to me one day and he said, Charles, because we had gotten to know each other, I hadn't waved enough and he felt safe and we became not quite friends, but we knew each other a little bit. And he knew me enough to come to one day and he says, I'll tell you one thing, you know, a lot of them are saying that they're not sure if they wanted you up here. He said, but I told them I'd rather have one Charles than 10 of them. I said, well, and I think that was his wonderful way of trying to say that he thought I was all right. I'll take one of you rather than 10 of them. And so Jim and Claire and I became good friends. Chris, the young single gal on the other end of the complex, became a good friend. And Mrs. Bartlett, who had a little dog, and she got to where she would bake cookies for me when I would travel out on ministry. And here I am. And it's a strong Jewish community, I discovered later. So I'm putting up all my Christmas and doing all this stuff, and I realized there was not many Christmas lights going up. And someone says, there's a synagogue right down the street for a reason. 97% of the people living up here are Jewish people. But, you know, again, who you are, what religion you are, does not stop us from being people like Christ that loves. So I didn't need to know what church they went to be Jesus to them. I didn't even need to know what faith they were a part of to be Jesus to them. And so I'm just loving them, and even Miss Bartlett's dog, and I'm not a dog lover, but she had a little dog. And I would play with Chi-Chi just as much as I would. But you know, one day came where Miss Bartlett came to church with me. And one day came when Jim got, some of my missionary friends were staying in my home, and I brought Miss Clara and Jim over to my house, and they got to know them. And I went on the road traveling, and my missionary friend led Jim to the Lord. When Jim passed away, Clara asked me to perform the service. But I came home one day, Jim, who's like the neighborhood policeman, the watch, he says, those guys over there, those teenage kids, they're using your water in your spigot. Because it was a condominium. I was on an in unit. I thought the in unit spigot, the water thing, was community. So I told Jim, he goes, nope, you pay for that. That's coming out of your bill. You need to stop them. You need to stop them from using your water. And I'm thinking, okay, thank you, Jim. So I'm in the house. I'm thinking, okay, now, Lord, I've never seen them using this little water spigot, this hydrant. So I just said, if that's the case, let me see it. So I just left it alone. I didn't go rushing over there to the neighbors and attacking them for using the water that I'm paying for. You just pray. And one day I came home, and sure enough, the hose was plugged in, and they were washing their cars, the teenage kids, to the neighbor. And I just waved at them like I always do, went inside, put all my groceries away, came back outside, and I approached them, and I spoke to them. And in doing so, they apologize. Well, we thought it was community. I said, so did I. I said, but I did call the water department. And they said, no, it's attached to your unit, and you pay for it. And they said, Mr. Graham, we're sorry. We'll not do it. We didn't realize it was, we thought it was community. I said, that's fine. I appreciate it. And they never used it again. But had I reacted like my neighbor wanted me to react, I wouldn't have won my neighbors. And do you know those neighbors, The lady has passed away, but the husband is alive, and he came. He's been to Arkansas to visit me twice now with his little dog, Lola. Lola passed away, and he got another one, Layla. But I'm telling you, when God says that we are to, and one that really got me, where it says here, be of the same mind one towards another in brotherly love. Years ago, I was in Arizona doing a meeting, a Valentine meeting at a little church in Thatcher, Arizona. And the average age of the Valentine attendees were 80 in this little church. And they had a little banquet hall back there in the fellowship hall, the table set up with the red ribbon and the Valentines on it. And every year I would go, okay, now who's been married the longest? You know, and I started, okay, who's been married for 3 years? Get up to 50 and 60, you know. But we have a lot of fun, and one little couple always would win every year until he passed away, and we still gave the award to her. But one year I was there for this banquet. I was in the pastor's study, and we walked out of his study, going across the breezeway into the fellowship hall, and a couple walked into the church. And there was another young man behind them, so I didn't really know the couple, and I didn't know the young man, but I thought they were all part of the church coming to the banquet. And so pastor greeted the couple, and they went past us, and he greeted this young man, and this young man's name was John. John had tattered hair, tattered clothes, looked a little ragged and disheveled, and so he said, is there a service tonight? And pastor says, yes, we have a banquet in the fellowship hall. He says, oh, I'm sorry, I saw all the cars. I thought it was a worship service. He says, well, it is. He said, you're welcome. And he said, well, I don't have a ticket, because he saw the other couple give pastor the tickets. And so the couple turned around and says, our neighbor couldn't make it, and we've got his ticket. So here you go. So they gave it to the young man. So we all went into the fellowship hall. So John and I were the youngest people there. Well, I had a good friend of mine from California with me named Stefan. Stefan worked at Nordstrom's, if you know anything about shopping. So he was a suit salesman at Nordstrom. So here's Stefan at the banquet with me. He'd travel over. And John, so the three of us was the youngest things in the whole evening. And as halfway through the meeting, I felt like the Lord said that John is not here by accident. And so I looked at him. I said, young man, I just want you to know God is saying that you're not here by accident tonight. And I said to the congregation, neither is he an accident for us. So we went on with the meeting, had the meeting, and we finished, and we went into the pastor's study, and we started talking to John. And in that meeting with John, we found out he's from Seattle, Washington, hitchhiking all the way down to Corpus Christi, Texas. Well, why are you doing that? Well, I'm getting ready to finish university. My mother's a PhD, my dad's a PhD, my brother's a PhD, my sister's a PhD, and I'm just seeking God to find out what he wants for me. Wow. And this is that tattered, shattered-looking kid in the pastor's study. And the first thing the Lord said to me was, at what point did you give your heart to John? And to be honest, it was after that statement. He no longer looked like who he was. And guess what I was preaching in the service that next Sunday? Romans 12. And the Lord just, because normally I stop up at the top where, you know, be not conformed to the world, but be transformed. That's where I stop. But God says, I want you to read down. And as I read down, it just talked about be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. In one translation, it says not to be, put the King James translation up there, my brother, of that verse. Is that good old King's? Well, God bless you. I think it says something about, loving those who may be at another lower estate. But what the bottom line is, that's when God says, I want you to read down and read that scripture. And that's when he said to me, when did you give your heart to John? It was after I knew that he was smart. Wow. Not because when he walked through the door looking ragged and tattered and torn. Oh, yeah, you do the Christian thing. Hello, brother. Welcome. But inside, this poor, dirty kid. And when he told us his story in the pastor's study, and so God says, I want you to. And so this is Friday night. And so on Saturday, well, that night after we left the pastor's study, we said, where are you staying? He said, I've got a tarpaulin set over here underneath someplace. And we said, well, can we put you in a hotel? No. So we insisted. So pastor put him in a hotel. We took him to Walmart, bought him some clothes. And he said, on Saturday, he said, I noticed as I was walking up, there were some roof tiles on your church. Your shingles were off. He says, I've learned to do that. He said, I'd be happy to come and help you, some guys, get your shingles put together. And he did that on Saturday. Then we went for a drive. And so on Sunday morning, we're sitting on the front row, me, my good friend Stefan, with his $700 suit, because he works at Nordstrom's, gets another good discount. And there's John in his Walmart clothes. And I'm ministering Romans 12. And I had to go on down to verse 9. And it was like, and I had to be honest with the people. And I said, remember when Friday night when God spoke to us in the banquet hall that he was not here by an accident? I said, John, you're not here by accident. And neither is he born by an accident for us. What I'm trying to say, my brothers and sisters, is God wants us to develop according to his word, not the world. And the world will attach itself to our first birth position. How are we born? I've got rich friends that's still born with problems. I've got poor friends who are still born with problems. So problems are going to be a part of our lives, our initial birth. I don't care. We can have the most perfect parents, but we may not have the best neighbors. We can have the best grandparents, but still going to be somebody at school that's going to bully you. So we're in a world that is cursed. So therefore, there is crazy in the world. And so we experience it. You know, I have good friends today that when I was in high school, we could not have been friends because the community did not allow us to be friends. I did not go into a white church until I was in college. I went to a little Christian college in southern Missouri, the first in my family to go to college. God worked it out through a white missionary that came to our town with the church. He had a son named Bubba, and he was in my art class. And if you're going to be a missionary in Southeast Arkansas, it's a good name to have for your son, Bubba. Bubba works. But Bubba's parents had been on the mission field. They had come from the north. When they came down south, we came into the school. He was my friend. I'll have to admit, I thought it was going to run out. That he's going to learn, you don't do that here. But it never ran out, and he stayed my friend. And one day when I got my letter from Oral Roberts University saying that I was accepted, but I didn't have enough money, Bubba went and told his mom and dad. They invited me for a meal. I'm thinking going into a white person's house. As a senior, I've mowed their lawns. I've eaten Fig Newton cookies, my little Birmingham buddy over here knows what those little Fig Newton cookies. And I'd get a Coke. You remember those little Cokes about that big? I called them little white lady Cokes. Because that's what I would get when I'd mow the lawns. I would get the little bottle of Coke and some Fig Newtons, sit out on the patio. Oh, boy, I tell you, these Fig Newtons are good with that little white lady Coke. I've got a white friend now. That's what I tell her. And she says, would you stop and get me some of those? I said, the white lady Cokes? Charles, stop saying that. I just like the little bottle of Cokes because you can put them in the freezer for 30 minutes and they chill just right. And she said all of her little grandmothers, the little white grandmothers, they would chill them for 30 minutes before the bridge meeting so they'll be nice and a little ice on them. You feel me, don't you? You know. But my brothers and sisters, let me tell you as we close today and all of that, because what God has done in my life has been so important. We can ignore Romans 12. but we won't get to Ephesians 4. In Ephesians 4, 15 says, but speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up. Grow up. Grow up in all aspects unto him who is the head, even Christ. If we're going to grow up in Christ, we cannot dismiss all of the commands and the lifestyles that God has called us to live. It doesn't matter where you were born, what you were born into. The word is for all. And so with all of that, I realized that in my life's journey, that if I was going to grow into that speaking the truth in love, about 2 years ago, the Lord allowed me to write a book. And the book tells the story of my journey. Growing up in the South, growing up with poor parents, but yet struggling with my faith, struggling with the God side of my faith, you know, the God side when it matches my reality. How can God be real and my life be such a tragedy, a mess, challenging? In high school, I asked my typing teacher, she's sweet, Christian, what would happen if I came to your church? And she lowered her head and she cried under her desk. And she said, Charles, if you came to my church, people would walk out because you're black. My shop teacher, ag teacher, always witnessing to the guys. I asked him one day, what would happen if I came to your church? And he thought for a moment and said, if I was the deacon on the door that Sunday, I would have to refuse your entry. So that was my natural reality. But it wasn't my spiritual reality. But I didn't allow my spiritual reality to be greater than my natural reality. And my natural reality caused me to have hurts, pains, and disappointments. And so when I left Arkansas, I left running. I was so glad to go to college in Missouri. And I just felt free. I thought, this is it. I'll never live in Southeast Arkansas again. I'll go home and visit mom and dad, but that's it. I will not live in Arkansas again. And as I journeyed through life, from Missouri to Oklahoma, where I finished Bible school, from Oklahoma to Southern California, and at every move, God would stir in my heart. I'm moving you from Missouri. Where do you want me? To Oklahoma. And then he moved me from Oklahoma to Southern California. And there came, and God allowed me to travel around the world. I used to dream and pray in the fields of Arkansas. God, just let me travel and sing for you. And I'd tell some people about my dream, and they would go, are you out of your mind? You're poor and you're black and you won't amount to much. Boy, stop dreaming. I wouldn't let them take my dream. My fourth grade teacher was a musician and an artist. And in that little old country school, segregated, God brought teachers into my life that encouraged me. And I, to this day, I love music and I love art. And I just wanted to sing. And it was as if, you know, I couldn't, the natural didn't speak to my future that God had planned for me. But how many know that Jeremiah 29:11 says, God says, I know the plans I have for you. But I'm saying, but look at this, it doesn't matter. I know the plans, but God, we get secondary textbooks, but I know the plans. When we integrated our students, the little country school where I went, we scored high, in some cases higher than most schools in the area. Why? Because a second-rate education didn't mean that we had second-rate teachers. And we had a mom and a daddy that would get on you if the teacher said you were bad. I'd never rest until the last teacher drove past our house going home. Because if that car slowed down in front of our house, I'm thinking, oh, Lord, I hope it's for Curtis. I hope it's for Joyce. I hope it's for Wanda. I hope she's not telling on me today. But God, he says, I know the plans. And in spite of all the stuff that my life consisted of as a child and as a teenager and as an adolescent, God has redeemed my life in such a way that after being in Southern California for 25 years, God says, I'm moving you. Again, a stirring came into my heart. And I thought, okay, where is it? I had gone to Africa, England, Scotland, Wales, Norway, Germany, France, Israel, Estonia.
and in music and ministry, and God has just so expanded my life and so removed me from the cotton fields of Arkansas, and I'm thinking, this is so amazing. And the day came where it was time to leave California. I flew to England because a friend offered me a job at a Bible school. Got there, and it wasn't what God was saying that he wanted from my life. Came back to the States, went to Missouri, went to Georgia, went to Tennessee, and God was in none of it. So I went back to California, said, I'll just stay here until you show me where you want me. Went home to Arkansas like I had done for 33 years at that point. Drove through what is called Skid Row, looking at the faces of the men and women that pretty much drink all day. And I would wave to them every year. I'd go home to see my mom and family. And as I waved to them this time, 33 years later, I'm waving at them, not even thinking anything but a wave, but as if I saw their faces for the first time, and God spoke to my heart between that place and my mother's home, and he says, I'm bringing you home to Arkansas. I'm thinking, I didn't see that one coming. The long and short of the story is, God brought me from Southern California back to Southeast Arkansas. I bought the farm where I picked cotton as a little boy. The house that I was not allowed in, only at the back door to collect my wages, is the house God has now trusted to me. It is now a ministry retreat facility. My dear brother and sister and their family have come up to visit. God's, when I renovated the house, God sent a church from Noonan, Georgia, of 32 churches down there, 35 white families came to help me renovate the house because a dear friend of mine, there's a music minister there, and he says, we want to come up and do a mission project with you. And God just keeps doing the impossible. What I didn't know as a little kid, God knew. And can I encourage you today? And people say, Charles, and even the easement of the 100 acres that I have, the easement of the bayou where I was baptized, I now own that easement. If anyone had told me that at the age of 10 that I would own the easement of the bayou where I was being baptized, I would have thought, you're crazy. But yet God says, I know the plans. And people say, what an amazing story that you can own the house you weren't allowed in or own the easement of the bayou that you were baptized in. And I said, that's a good story, but it's not the story. The story is that God would trust me to go home, love, and serve the people. My brothers and sisters, God, over the years, Romans 12, he's worked it in my heart. And he continues to work it in my heart. I have to be mindful not to render evil for evil. I have to be mindful to be kind to those that are unkind to me. And a lot of my friends who've read the book, it says, Charles, we've known you for 40 plus years and we've never known your story. I said, because I couldn't tell the story until God redeemed my story. Had I told you my story before God redeemed my story, all you could have done is carried my hurts. But when God heals my hurts, there are no hurts for you to carry. And so, my brothers and sisters, can I leave with you this morning? Your hurts, your pains, and disappointments may look different than mine, but guess what? We all have them. And the same God that brought redemption to my story in such a drastic way that allowed me to move back to the place of my pains and my hurts and my disappointments and be a ministry there is only a testimony of God's grace in my life, and for that I'm grateful. I didn't write the book until almost 10 years after I had been back in Arkansas, because it's one thing to say, I forgive you or I love you. There's a whole, I could have done that in California, and I thought I loved them, and I thought I'd forgiven them. But it was the 10 years living there, because when I moved back, purchasing the house, the realtor didn't return my calls. But do you know the realtor today and her husband are supporters to the ministry? But I didn't get angry. I'm learning that living out of our redeemed lives, there's a purpose for it. Can I tell you that it's for our health, it's for our good. All that God is encouraging us to live here in Romans 12 so that we can go to the Ephesians 4:15 where we can speak our truth in love. Because when our truth is spoken in love, then there is life in that. Because you can tell your story then and it doesn't cause people to just hurt for you because you're not hurting anymore. So can I encourage you today? Let God bring the healing. We want to escape the stuff. He said, in the world, you're going to have tribulation. He said, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Can you be kind to those that are unkind to you? Absolutely. Can you be gracious to those that are not gracious to you? You can. This last scripture I want to leave with you is found in Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, it says, make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgives you, so you must forgive others. My brothers and sisters, there's no way that I could be living back in Southeast Arkansas. I've been forgiven, but God says, take it the next step. Now forgive. As we just take a moment, I want you to just close your eyes and let God minister to your hearts. The journey of forgiveness is worth it. I've seen majestic mountains crafted by your hands. I've heard the sea applaud you as it crashed against the land. You hung a million stars in heaven's vast expanse, and all creation lifts their song of praise. You amaze me when I think of all you've done. Lord, you amaze me. My heart is overcome by your mercies. Fill my life with peace. Lord, you never cease to amaze me. You see the tiny sparrow, know when it can't fly. You hear the smallest prayer and keep the tears we cry. Your glory fills the earth, and yet you live inside. Every heart that calls upon your name, you amaze me when I think of all you've done. Lord, you amaze me. My heart is overcome by your mercies. You fill my life with peace. Lord, you never cease to amaze me. When I realize your greatness as you reign upon your throne, I'm astonished you have chosen us and called us as your own. As your own. Lord, you amaze me when I think of all you've done. Lord, you amaze me. Overcome by your mercies. Fill my life with peace. Lord, you never cease to amaze me. A friend once said, he doesn't surprise me, but he does amaze me. Let God amaze. Let's pray together. Father, thank you this morning for your very presence, not just in this room, but in us. I thank you for the family of Hope Rock Church. Father, thank you for your hand upon this church, and you've called it into existence for a divine purpose to be a light and a testimony of your love and your grace, your power, your salvation, your redemption to people. So thank you for that. We thank you that no weapon formed against it has prospered, will prosper, or is prospering. Amen. Father, we thank you. We speak life, continued life, divine life to this church and its people. Father, we thank you that you continue to cause it to be all that you've called it to be and planned for it to be. You know the plans you have for every member. And thank you, Lord, that you're redeeming the stories, you're redeeming the lives, you're causing your redemption to come into play in their hearts and their lives. And Father, for that, we're grateful. And they will rise up to serve you with strength and with might and with your provision and all that you have for them. They will not serve from a place of their first birth, but Father, that we're going to walk from the position of our second birth. We thank you that as redeemed men and women, boys and girls, that God, we will walk from a redemptive place. Our words will be spoken from a redemptive place, Father. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So Father, we know that the world has a rhetoric today, and we pray for the world. But Father, we can address issues and miss the real fact and point. And what the world needs is Jesus. So let us be Jesus. May we never get caught up in the rhetoric of the world, but let us always declare the word of the Lord. And so, Father, we thank you that I speak now to past pains, hurts, and disappointments. And even as you brought the Hebrew boys out of the fiery furnace, and your word says, without even the smell of smoke on them. Thank you that you've redeemed us in such a way that, Father, not even the smell of smoke is on us. Let us live in your redemptive power, walk according to your promise and not the world. And we give you praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Well, I mean, I don't know about you all, but I was blessed big time. So, Charles, what a blessing. Thank you for sharing with us, for being just who you are. What a blessing. So, we appreciate it. I'm sure every one of us is leaving here today taking something of what Charles has said into our hearts. I mean, I'm just blown away by God's goodness. So, Charlie and Crystal, thank you for bringing Charles, who's now a new friend of ours, into this church. And you're more than welcome to come here, Charles, whenever you want. We'll even feed you some nice Texas food. Okay. Not that I know anything about it, because I'm from South Africa. But anyway, so thank you very much. We're just so grateful. Tim, you want to come pray for us before we end? And then we're going to sing one last worship song. The worship team, no worship today, because we've worshipped enough, right? Amen. So pray for us, Tim, and take it home.
Pretty cool. Let's close our eyes. Let's pray. Lord, we just say thank you for just, feeling like our hearts have been fed with a fire hydrant of your love. That's what my heart feels like. It can't contain any more. And I think, Father, as we go from here, as we see ourselves interacting with those who may know you and those who don't know you in this week, would we interact with them from the overflow of what's just been poured into us, that we would just let your love season our speech, our thoughts, our actions with those that we live at home with, all the way to our clients, to our people standing in line, even though it's social distancing, Father, we would interact with all those that we meet from a place of just your love, of what we've just had deposited into our hearts, Lord. Would we just minister from that overflow? Lord, we just ask you, Father, in Jesus' name, to bless Charles. Lord, as he's come here to just minister us, would you minister to him and just bless him? Father, we just say thank you for a wonderful man of God just following after you. What an example that he is, Lord. Would you bless us all as we go forth today? In Jesus' name, amen. We'll see you guys next week.